Hello. Hi, everyone. How's it going? Well, I guess we can't hear you.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. Hello. Hello. Would you like to introduce yourself, Miss Miori?
Oh, okay. Hello. The name is Miori Celesta. I am a local Isekai guild leader VTuber. Today, I'm not dressed as a guild leader, but to match it, I'm in my casual attire. Hello.
Hello. Yes, hello, hello. Some of you guys might know me, some of you guys might not. My name is Uzuki Tomoya, and I am Tsunderia's residential marshmallow bunny rabbit from Generation TsunDream. Nice to meet you guys, and welcome to Offkai, if you're just stopping by. Hello, hello!
Yay!
Hope you guys are enjoying it. Yeah, Pog!
Welcome to our mix panel. Today, we're going to spend some time talking about cover mixing, especially cater towards VTubers, V-singers, and people that record at home. I would just like to start off with a preface that this panel will be split into two sections. The first half will kind of be a little slideshow, and the second half will be Tomo actually showcasing our little mix for Daddy Daddy Do on his DAW. Very exciting.
Yes. I hope you all are very interested to learn about the inner workings of mixing and cover production. So,
yeah.
Without further ado, let's jump in and show them what happened, how it works.
Oh my gosh. Okay. I would just like to say that before we begin, neither of us are professionals. We are just hobbyist mixers. So, please do bear with us. This is all going to be like very basic information.
Mm-hmm.
And also, I need to hold on.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to be like lecturing anyone. Let me get on my.
Oh, your glasses. Wow. You know what they say about glasses. They're so versatile. And I forget the rest of the copypasta.
Excuse me? Are you talking to me? Hello? Wow, okay. Anyways, right. Listen up, kiddos. All right.
I have the audio, by the way. Oh, I can show you guys why is mixing important. So before we get into the presentation itself, I will show you guys a little spliced together version of the cover you just heard, but with the unmixed version and the mixed version kind of fading in and out. And I trust you guys will be able to tell which one is which. So without further ado, take a listen here. Okay, there it goes. All right. So you can see there's definitely a really big difference between when it's just plain and when it has all the effects in. And I personally prefer the mixed version. Some may differ in opinion, but but either way, it's the product of both of our hard work. So
yes,
I hope you guys will be interested. Yeah.
Details.
Yeah. So, take it away, Miori. I'll give it to you here.
Thank you. Okay. Oh my gosh. Ooh, I have control over your smells. Ooh. Ooh. So why is mixing important? The purpose, so what we do is we blend vocals and the instrumental together so that it's nice to listen to and it sounds polished. And I would say it's probably one of the most essential things to making a good cover. And it is as important as the vocals themselves. And we can actually simplify this to vocal cleanup, which is noise removal, click removal, all the stuff that we can remove before we actually get into everything. And then editing, tuning and timing, which is usually what I do. And the effects. So that this is the frequency shaping, compressing, leveling, reverb, which is what Tomo usually does when we do things together. And by the way, this screenshot on over here is actually a screenshot from one of Tomo's mixing streams. I believe it's his
magnet. That looks like magnet.
Yeah, it is your magnet. And for today's showcase, I have used Melodyne and Reaper to edit, and Tomo will be using Reaper to show his mix. So those are the programs that we're using today. I also have it written out in another slide at the end, so you'll be able to see it. So that's basically kind of what mixing is.
Mm-hmm.
And I also kind of wanted to go into the technicalities of like a recording before we jump into like the actual mix, because mixing is magic and good quality recordings will ensure a better mix.
True. All so, facts, no printer. Okay.
So,
sorry, I had to do it.
Shut up. Let us start with some microphones. Let us start with a microphone talk.
But Miori, what's a microphone?
I know. My favorite thing in the world. This is going to be the wordiest slide of today. And I'm going to just zoom through it. Feel free to like take a picture if you want. But
this is your college lecture. This will be on the exam.
Yes. This is why. Oh, there's going to be a quiz on this. So we can usually separate microphones into a dynamic microphone and a condenser microphone. This is a very condensed version of what they are. So take it with a grain of salt. Dynamic microphones usually have a warmer sound, so like a less sharper sound, a lower sensitivity, and a narrower frequency range. It's good for singers with untreated rooms, so like with room verb, which I will also explain in the next slide. It's good for loud vocals. And a popular example is the Shure SM7B, which is actually what me and Tomo are using right now.
Oh, right? Yeah. Wait, you got a 7B? When'd you get a 7B?
I'm literally using it right now!
I didn't know you got one!
Excuse me?
That's
I'm
so fun!
I talked to you about it. Okay. Anyways. Next are condenser microphones, and these are usually what's used for most vocals. It has a brighter sound or a sharper sound. It has a higher sensitivity. It has a wider frequency range. So it's good for singers with darker voices where their voices are naturally just a bit more bassy and boomy or less airy. It's for those who want more detail in their recordings. And a popular example of this is the AT2020. The condenser microphone that I use is the Rode NT1, and it's the one that I use for my most recent original song that was also mixed by Tomoya.
Oh yeah, Ride Your Day. Ride Your
Day.
Ride the Day. Right. Okay.
And I just wanted to explain a little bit between a difference between an XLR and a USB microphone. XLR microphones are better quality. It uses an XLR cable. It needs an audio interface to power it. USB microphones are simple to set up, but cheap and easily portable.
Love
and
cheap.
And we will always recommend the XLR for quality, but if you are tight on a budget, then USBs work fine too.
Just kidding. Here's cheap. Don't love cheap.
It works if it works. Here are just some examples of common microphones for each type. First one is the SM7B. Second one is the Rode NT1. Third one is the Fifan K669S. And my fans know that is like the USB microphone that I recommend to literally everyone.
That thing is insane. The people who use that are insane. Why? That's insane! That's insane! That's insane!
Get it. Get
Why? It. I don't need to get it, but still, it's insane. Okay.
It's just so good.
Oh my gosh. Okay. So, we're nerds. Sorry.
A little random, this whole entire panel is just nerd talk. Anyways, now that that's over with, let's get into the actual recording stuff. Here are some of the terminologies that you might come across when talking about recordings and mixing. And these are usually the most common issues and how we go around about fixing them from like a mixer's view.
Mm-hmm.
First up, clipping. Very common issue. Overly loud. It's when a overly loud recording produces a distortion in the sound. You can see on the right that the ends of these waveforms at the top at the bottom, they're like blocked off
because the input
signal is too loud. So a common fix is to lower the microphone gain until you're not clipping at when you're singing at your loudest.
Mm-hmm. That's what all my streams look like on the right there.
Yeah.
Just kidding. When I accidentally mess up my audio, that's what some streams look like. Anyways.
It's very important. It's so important. This is very hard to fix. And all the issues that we're going over today can be fixed with certain plugins. Like there's plugins that will act as a declipper and will try to fix the audio, but they don't work as well. So we want to get rid of these issues at the source. We want to get rid of these from the recording.
Yeah, my technique is usually to give up and move on. Anyways.
Oh my God. Next one is room reverb, the one that I mentioned beforehand. It is when an echo occurs in the recording from an untreated room. This usually happens when your room is really big and it's very empty, so there's a lot of space for the sound to just kind of bounce around.
Mm-hmm. Remember, and kids, yes, treat your rooms right. Sorry, keep
yes,
going.
Yes, treat your rooms right. It's like when people practice like their violin in like the bathroom because they say like the acoustics are good because there's like an echo. We want our recordings to be as dry or with as little room reverb as possible. We want it to be like clean. So fixes to this is getting closer to the microphone, investing in a dynamic microphone, or using an isolation shield like the one on the right. They don't do 100% removal of room reverb, but it does work. It does work.
Mm-hmm.
And the third issue that I'll explain is microphone distance.
Big one.
This is so important.
Big
the amount
one.
Of VTubers that I have had to go.
Don't throw them under the bus.
Because they're recording or streaming from their microphone like a foot away. Okay. I would just like
don't
to
bring
say
feet
that
into
in a
this.
Studio
sorry.
Environment. Sorry.
No, I'm just kidding.
In a studio environment, you want to be like 10 centimeters away, but at home, where most 99% of people at home aren't going to have studio treated rooms, you're going to get a lot of room verb. So you want to be pretty close to 2 inches to 5 centimeters away. If you're recording too far, you get really thin vocals, a lot of background noise, and more room verb in your recording. If you're too close, you get really boomy and bassy vocals with more plosives. And plosives, I'll also get to in the next slide.
Yeah, or we could just demonstrate them. Here, pull into your... No, just kidding. Okay.
It's like when... Yeah, it's like when... You know when like you blow air into your microphone, it's like...
It's hey, like don't that. Give them free content. Hey, yo. people are into that. Save that for a short, oh, Mio.
Check out Miori Celesta on YouTube. I hate you. Okay.
Okay, next.
All right. Hold on. Oops. Okay. And the issues on this slide are usually done in post-processing. So this is usually part of the mixing process, getting rid of these issues. First up, background noise. And this can be fan noise, headphone bleed, when the instrumental from the headphone bleeds into the microphone, and like constant humming. It can be like static or like cable issues or whatever. And of course, you want to like close all your windows, turn off your fans, turn off your AC, use earbuds instead of open back headphones if the headphone bleed is too much. Or in mixing, we can run a denoiser plugin, like the one on the right.
Ooh, pictures.
And we can also remove humming frequencies with an EQ. And I just want to show you this space here. You can see like these blue lines and like a little orange line on the bottom. This is the noise. So this is before noise removal. The difference isn't huge because this is my line from today.
Mio's too clean.
These are from my line. you can see that the space here is a lot darker, and you can see that a lot of this stuff has been sort of removed from the recording.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see it's going to be a lot cleaner.
Mm-hmm.
That's what noise removal does. Yep. Oh, yes.
That said, if your fan is going like... and is louder than your voice in the recording, there is not much we can do. So just a note on that. Yeah. It's happened. Don't talk
make
to me
sure
about
to
that.
Make sure to try and minimize it as much as possible in the recording so that you may get clean sounding good mix and you don't kill us.
Yes.
We die.
We die after processing so many of these. So I have a limit of about five more left in my lifespan. Okay. Next.
You're funny. You don't even have
I don't have a lifespan.
Okay, next one. I'll be going into mouth clicks and plosives. Sibilants are the harsh S sounds that sound really sharp and hissy to the point where it like kind of hurts your ears.
Cool.
And for these, we'll usually run a plugin called a de-esser. Actually, all of these will usually just have like D at the beginning and then whatever it's removing at the end.
Hey, Mio, is there a D's nuts? I'm sorry. Fuck. Ignore me.
Can you guys all just like all point and laugh at him?
Stop! No.
I can't believe you did this. Okay.
Sorry. A little excited.
Next are mouth clicks. Some words will cause like a little click sound in the recording at the end of a phrase when the tongue is like smacking the roof of the mouth. So you know that sound where it's like...
That's so weird.
Stop! I'm just giving a demonstration!
Okay.
And we will remove these with a de-clicker. As I said before, usually it's like D and then it'll have whatever is removing at the end. And plosives. These are the harsh P sounds that I mentioned earlier, where like air is hitting the microphone really quick and it calls like that noise. So the de-esser, de-clicker, and deplosive plugins will help in removing those. These are a little harder to take care of in the recording, so we'll usually just do these in post-processing.
True.
But yeah, so those five issues are the most common ones that we tackle when we mix, and issues that people might run into when they're recording at home. But there are definitely ways to minimize them. So keep those in mind if you're starting out recording.
Yep.
Okay.
What she
so
said.
So that was kind of like everything before we get into the actual mix. So after, okay, so we have our recordings and we have post-processed them. Now what do? Yeah, vocal editing.
Wow, and I would have never guessed. Oh my God.
That's crazy.
Yo,
this is
okay.
Where the magic comes in, people. Yeah. So this is my favorite thing to do. Tuning. And tuning is manually aligning notes to the correct pitch. It is not auto-tune. Auto-tune is a
auto-tune's what I use. Just kidding. I mean, not kidding, true. But like...
Yeah. No. He does use auto-tune. But auto-tune is more of like an effect. It's not... Auto-tune isn't the thing that makes your notes sound like they're on pitch. It's just the thing that makes you sound like you're T-Pain. Like a So that's different. That's different. It's not the same. I have to do this manually. I have to drag notes up and down manually.
It's true. It's true. I've witnessed it.
So here's a little visual representation from my lines from Daddy Daddy Do. So you can see where it goes up and down. You can see like the notes on the left. So this is like anata no subete. Wait, no, hold on. Anata no subete ga. You can see where the notes are going up and down, and basically I'll be dragging them up and down and manually editing them so that they sound on pitch.
Yeah.
And you can do a lot of things in tuning. You can flatten notes. You can add more like shakiness to a note. It's very, I think vocal editing is one of the most important things in a mix. So it's very important that we try to do vocal editing in a way that is really natural and really enhances the recording.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then there's timing. Can't forget about that.
Oh, yes.
And this is now aligning
activity.
And stretching syllables to the beat. This is the worst thing to
this
do.
This is the worst thing. I hate it so much.
We hate it so much.
But it's important.
You can see here. So each syllable here is basically stretched so that they align together. So you can see that I stretched the end of this file here to align with the ending of the file above. You can see that this one is slowed down and this one's like a little faster with the numbers here. So this is anata no tsubete ga.
Anata no tsubete ga. Yeah.
And to speed this process up, we usually will set our project BPM to the BPM of the song, and you can see that these are actually on the aligning to the grid. So this is like at the half of the grid here. These dark gray lines are basically each beat. So that speeds up the process a little bit.
Mm-hmm. But we still have to time each syllable manually. So
yeah, we have to do all of this manually.
Every single note you've ever heard, main harmony, melody, we have touched that with our hands and moved it exactly to the right position on the beat. So
yes, we
still have to go
for this.
Jeez.
And as I mentioned in the beginning, for our Daddy Do cover example today, we used tuning, Melodyne for tuning, Reaper for timing, and Reaper for the mix as well. So I did the tuning and timing, and Tomo did the mix.
Yeah.
And so that is basically my portion for the panel.
Yeah.
I hope that gave you some more insight into the world of recording and vocal editing. Now, Tomo is going to whisk you away his DAW.
Well, almost. Before we get into the DAW, I would like to show you guys a little a little explanation. Oh, no. That's awkward. Anyways, so I'm going to break down the mixing process a little bit. This is what happens when you copy Miori's slides and you didn't realize they had transitions.
This is what happens when you're unprepared.
This is what happens when you make this 5 minutes before their presentation. Anyways. So this is kind of the breakdown of why are there two number sixes? The last one should be number seven. Anyways, this is how I break down kind of conceptually all I do in a mix. So first, I do some extra processing and cleanup. That's all the D's, as Mio was talking about. And for me, I personally like to slap on auto-tune. What this does is it kind of cleans up all the tuning. So it kind of locks in things, and it just makes things sound a little bit more professional. What it also does, which you may understand if you know have a little bit of a music background or sound background, is it adds harmonics into the mix or into your track, which then adds extra brightness and character that wasn't there initially. So auto-tune is a great tool for that, but I wouldn't rely on it necessarily for pitch accuracy. While it does have a pitch accuracy function, it's a little bit harsh, and I much prefer the natural sound of Melodyne with auto-tune on top of it. It just makes things sound really clean. Next is equalization, which I'll talk about a little bit more, but it's easier to demonstrate, which we'll get into. But basically, it's kind of shaping your sound so it's less dark, less boomy, maybe brighter. It's kind of changing the character. While compression, the next step is more approaching the volume versus the actual content of the frequency spectrum. So this is kind of tightening up, making the loud parts sound quieter and the quiet parts sound louder, so you have a more even sound. For example, it just brings out a lot of detail in parts where you're maybe singing quieter, and it compresses a lot of the detail where you're maybe singing louder. And different compressors have different algorithms and things that kind of change the character of the sound as they adjust this volume. So different compressors can really help elevate the sound of your mix. It's really, really an awesome tool. Next, I do spatial effects, which include doubling, imaging, and some modulation, which I'll show also. But this is basically making the vocals wide once you kind of have them locked into a certain place. So you're wondering, like, well, why does one mix sound like all the vocals are in the center and the other one sound like they're spread out a little bit? Is it panning or is it spatial effects? And most of the time, at least in my mixes, it's spatial effects, which I use to kind of create impact, contrast, and difference, which I find is really interesting. Versus panning is also a great tool, which I can talk about a little bit later. Finally, or not finally, but number five, we have reverb, which helps glue. Once you kind of shape the vocals into the form you want, it glues it into the instrumental, and it kind of ties them together in a way where there's kind of this, the echo of the instrumentals, the reverb of the instrumentals will match with the reverb of the vocals, and you get this nice, glued sound is the best way to describe it. But honestly, the best way will be to hear it, as I will be showing soon. Finally, number six, master vocal cleanup. This is just some light touches. We use a plugin called Soothe 2, both Mio and I, which helps kind of pull out any harshness that's left on top. There's also some saturation that can come in at this point. And just overall nice stuff. It's very subtle. It's very just like, oh, shoot, I messed this thing up earlier and I don't want to go back to fix 50 tracks. I'm just going to fix it all when it goes through the funnel at the end. Finally, number six, because I forgot to write number seven, is mastering, which is adjusting the sound of the entire track, not just the vocals. To be clear, steps one through six, number one, we're all on touching up the vocals only, but mastering impacts both the master tracks, or both the original instrumental and the master and the vocals themselves. So when you want to change the overall volume of the track, for example, you bring the instrumental down and you want to bring it back up, you would do that with mastering. If you want to kind of change the way the song sounds from the original CD sound, this is what mastering is for. So it's a really powerful tool, and I'm not an expert on mastering. I'm more of a mixing dude, but it's definitely really interesting, and I can showcase some of that as well. So without further ado, thank you so much for that part. We're going to get into the live demonstration. But if you haven't seen it already, you can scan the QR code up top to check out our full cover, or not full cover, but our YouTube version of the cover that dropped at 2:30 a.m. PDT last night. I'm really fucking tired. It's up there.
Is my head covering it? Do you have to move me down?
Oh, wait, I can't tell.
Yeah,
I can't tell.
Check it out.
Oh, you're breaking your neck. Oh, my God. Oh, yeah. Hold on. I'm going to move you down.
Thank you.
Yeah. Wow, I'm so tall. Yes, stream Daddy Daddy Do covered by Tomoya and Miori.
Yes.
Yeah. It's a cool cover. It's what you just heard earlier, but with a different background. You know, we have the Offkai Expo special for you guys.
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to move Mio's head back up to block the rest of the QR code. Sorry, scrubs. And we're going to jump over to the recording screen, or not recording screen, but you know, the mixing screen. So
let's go.
Alrighty, here we are. So, is this the right one? Oh, this is the right one. So, without further ado, we're going to get into the mix. I am going to show you how we have broken down this from stage one to stage six and a half. But I'm actually going to showcase Mio's parts as well. So it's more like 11 steps, but I don't want to keep track. Anyways, I'm just going to make sure the sound is playing right here. And we're just going to play some different parts of it. So let's jump around to here. This is just the completely raw lines. No tuning, no timing. To be honest, we were kind of fire in these recordings, so it's pretty good, but yeah, let's play it. Very dry, clearly bad. And then we add in, what's this one? Okay, well, then we add in tuning. Sorry, I forgot to say, I have an acapella showcase as well, so I'm gonna showcase the acapellas for these two. So this is the untuned. This is untuned, untimed acapella. You can tell the harmonies are kind of clashing a little bit. But Mio still sounds fire. What the hell? Where's the part where I'm really off key? Okay, you sound perfect. I hate this. Oh, I was flat on the do. The na went flat. And then, yeah, the harmonies kind of clash there. Then we add in the tuning. And it just clicks, right? It just locks in. It's so cool. The harmonies lock in. And then we swap into the version with the instrumental, and this is all tuned and timed. Not volume, not balanced. I'll play through the chorus a little bit. Those harmonies really lock in now into place. Okay, before I start singing along, we're gonna stop. Okay, now we're gonna throw on auto-tune for comparison and some vocal cleanup. Just a little sharper, very subtle. This is one of the most minor steps, but it becomes exaggerated with other parts of the mix. Okay, before I keep listening to it, the next step we'll put in the EQ. She's clearly a lot brighter. I sound exactly the same because I don't do stuff to my voice. Wow, I don't EQ myself at all. And then we go on to the compression. This should be a big difference. This is where it starts banging, if you know what I mean. You got the vocals are just a lot more thick and a lot stronger, a lot more in your face, and they seem to match a little bit more with the instrumental. And now this is where the magic happens, I think. Here's the multi-band compressor step, which I forgot to mention. Really sharpens everything up. Also includes saturation, such as my favorite, fresh air. Okay, Okay. The next part is spatial effects, which will make it much wider. It's got that pop process sound to it now. It really starts kicking there. And finally, we have the reverb. Just fills in that space a little more. And we're almost there. We got some final cleanup here, which is just going to touch up the frequencies, tune it back a little bit, and... And finally, we're gonna play the master, which is the louder version. It's been limited, it's been kind of tweaked to perfection, and this is what you've heard on the live stream. Oh god. She's still controlling the mouse. Okay. All right. I don't know how to remove the mouse control video. Anyways, so.
Oh.
Yes.
Sorry. Quick question. All
yes.
Right, you lovely folks sitting down. How are the speakers there? Can you like hear the difference? Give me like a thumbs up.
Yeah.
I'm just like so curious.
Does it sound exactly the same?
Can you actually hear the difference between the files?
Oh, okay.
Yes. Okay.
Yes. Kind of,
okay.
Yes, that's okay.
All right. I just wanted to say that we are recording this and we will try to upload it on someone's channel. So if you hear it with like actual headphones or like earbuds, it might be easier to hear.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or put your ear next to the speaker. Just kidding. Don't do that. Okay. Anyways, yeah, I do want to speed through some of the mixing stuff here over on the actual project file. And then hopefully we can answer like 10 minutes of questions at the end. So I'd love to hear that. Or I'd love to see what you guys have to ask, if you would like to ask anything related to this panel or I don't know, other questions about VTubers. But
yeah, okay. We actually like don't know.
What do you mean we don't know?
Like, how do we
how do we do questions? Staff. we can't hear anything through the room, so it is what it is, but We'll have to figure it out. Anyways, so I'm going to pull up a little effects window here, and we're going to look at what we got here. So I'm just going to breeze through you guys quickly on what we have. We have a deplosive because I forgot to use my pop filter. Don't worry about it. We have this wonderful program called Spiff, which is kind of part of that cleanup here. It's doing some removing mouth clicks because I go like... whatever when I sing. We got auto-tune, the favorite Antares auto-tune, input type low male, because I am low and I'm a male. Anyways, and we got some settings dialed in here, kind of less tuned, more human, a little less vibrato. I don't know what's going on there. I just use the kind of the default settings and it sounds good. Next, we got my EQ. I'll explain a little bit of this. Basically, for vocal EQ, you want to chop out a lot of this low resonant region because if you see on the graph, nothing. That's cool. Why? Oh, I'm on the wrong track. It's okay. So there's not much content down here. And there's a lot more content up here. Generally, the high part of the voice is like that sounds and the brighter parts. I can actually solo this for you guys. So you really want to hear a lot more of those high-end parts and less of this thing that I've chunked out here. Let me just show you guys what this is. It's just a honky noise. Basically, in my opinion, it sounds like shit, so I take it out. Anyways, and then finally we take out some of this low end here, which is just thickness. So no EQ. With EQ. It's very subtle, but it just makes the vocals a little bit brighter. Next is compression. I like this FabFilter Pro C2. It's very solid for some just generic compression, vocal, fast attack, long release. It just kind of dials in that stuff. Next I use R compressor, which is a slower attack compressor. You can see the first one was 0.25 milliseconds. This one's 16 milliseconds. Where's that? Yeah, 16 milliseconds. So it's order of magnitudes slower on the attack, and this kind of just puts some grab into the vocals. It's cool. And finally we have, or not finally, we have OTT, which I have learned about recently from a few VTubers such as Miori, Celesta, and Athena Nightingale, who use and worship this plugin. This just makes everything really, really bright. So off, kinda thick. So that's cool. Then we have this multi-band compressor that's kind of doing stuff. It's just a little bit, makes it a little bit cleaner. And finally, my favorite plugin of all time, saturator called Fresh Air, which brightens everything up. It kind of does something similar to OTT without the compression. You may be able to hear it. You might not be able to. That's okay. It's very bright. It just brings everything to life. It's like that song from Evanescence. Anyways, so next we have our spatial effects, which I'll go into. I'm gonna switch to a different part of the song. Let's just go for the acapella on the mains here. So we'll sing with a part with both of us together. And I'm just gonna turn off all the spatial effects and turn them on one by one. So doubling brings that space in, imager, a little bit more width, Saturn, saturation. Little bit brighter, very subtle. I don't think it does anything. Actually, I could take it out. And then this is a modulator, which spreads things out more. Off. On. You will notice it more with headphones. Don't know if it sounds good on the speakers. That's okay. Anyways, next we have our... I have another compressor here. I don't want to talk about this one. This one's just jank. Reverb coming on. So, no reverb. Reverb on. How I like to split up reverb is I take the early reflections. This is going to be extremely technical. I don't think I have time to go into this. Basically, I split up the reverb to the early part and the late part. This is how the early and late sound together. I add on another one because I like reverb. Big reverb. Pro Q coming in. Or Pro R. Pro R. And finally, delay. Actually, delay is really interesting, so I do want to talk about delay a little bit. Delay is really good because it creates this ping pong effect in your vocals and makes it fill the space a lot better. So, this is how it sounds. It's very quiet. Let me bring it up a little bit. It's really just ping ponging back and forth. It's really wonky, but when you put it down low in the mix, it really just glues it all together. And finally, my Vocs Master effects. We have a de-esser coming in a little later, which will help tame those S's a little bit that are very bright coming in from OTT and Fresh Air. We have a dynamic EQ, which is just kind of like smoothing out frequencies a little bit more. Soothe 2, soothing out frequencies also, as the name provides. Fresh Air to brighten up the mix a little bit more. Mio, I didn't tell you about this, but I did this. some corrective EQ on the vocal mix. This one's interesting. It's a lot thicker without it. Or a lot thicker with those frequencies, and I put the EQ on, and it's a lot less thick. It's really cool. Why do I have another dynamic EQ? I don't want to talk about this, but basically I ripped the vocals from the original track. I matched their EQ with our vocals, and then I overlaid that EQ spectrum on top of ours so we would match with the original. But that's very technical, and I will not talk about that. anyways, we're rushing through because we're very short on time for questions. So for the last section, I'm just going to blast through on mastering. Again, you'll be able to watch the VOD, take pictures, take notes later. And I do mixing streams all the time, but occasionally. So you're free to stop by. Mio does mixing streams as well. Free to stop by, check out, and see more in detail and ask more one-on-one questions when these come up. But yes, OTT, really, really solid plugin. Again, and I like this on the master because it just grips everything together a little bit more. So let me grab a part of the mix here. No OTT. It's lagging because my computer's weak. Just glues everything together. I have another Soothe 2, soothing out frequencies. My Ozone 9 mastering plugin, which is doing some EQ matching, some dynamic EQ reduction, and finally limiting. Now, I do want to talk a second about limiting. Limiting is basically taking everything above a certain threshold and pushing it up until a ceiling. So it's like a big compressor on like steroids. And it is very, your mix won't be the same without limiting because this is the step that really glues everything together. It takes all the parts that are quiet and brings them into the same range as the parts that are loud. So I'll take the maximizer or limiter off. Maximizer. And we'll get into it. So no limiter. It's just a huge volume shelf. Anyways, don't mind the lag. Finally, over the top of it all, I just have a little bit of a tonal balance control. This just shows me, am I in the target range for the right type of genre? This is called jazz, the jazz setting. So it takes the EQ spectrum, and it looks at our spectrum within the accepted range. Looks like we're okay. And finally, I took an EQ match of the original song and ours, overlaid it, and we got some interesting peaks, boosts, and reductions to see overall, to kind of match our song to the original, make it sound similar while also still having our voices in it. Oh, so okay, we have 5 minutes left.
Like 5 to 10. I think there's quite a lot. Wait, I think
there's quite a lot. Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so I can read them to you.
Can we take questions?
Yeah, we can. I'm in the Discord.
Oh, sweet. So, okay, that's great.
A few people have asked some questions in the Discord. So mm-hmm. I'll go through them. I guess we can like take turns answering or whoever wants to.
Yeah. You know, whoever can answer it best, yeah.
All right, first question. What do you find to be the hardest, most time-consuming part of the mixing process?
Timing. Hands down.
We hate timing so much. Next question. How did you get used to mixing your own voice? I can answer it. You can answer it.
Yeah, we can both answer this one. This is a good one.
Yeah, I got used to it because I listened to so many other people's. And the reason why a lot of people hate their own voice is because you keep comparing it to all these other studio vocalists have already edited their vocals.
Right.
You know that's not perfect. They are not perfect. And once you get into like listening to other like normal people's like raw recordings, you realize that like that's just like people just don't record perfectly. And once you like get into that mindset, you start being like, okay, so mine aren't actually that bad.
Right, absolutely. I just realized you were pretty quiet this entire time. I'm so sorry.
I was. Could you?
I'm sorry. Either way, I would say to answer this question, I have a similar answer. When you hear yourself back through the phone, that's an awful recording. Don't judge your voice off your phone recording. So much of how you perceive your voice is through recording. And when the recording quality is very not good and you compare it to how you hear a lot of people's other voices sound, it will resonate. It will dissonantly resonate with you, and it will be really weird. But once you hear yourself mixed, it's kind of how you hear yourself in your head. Because when you hear yourself in your head, obviously it sounds very different from when you record. And kind of my goal always has been taking my voice in the recordings and shaping it to sound like how it sounds in my head or better. Or when I say in my head, you know, like from your own ears. There's a scientific reason for that. It's because the bone conduction actually is closer when you're actually speaking from your own self, so you hear yourself differently.
Right.
Anyways, mm-hmm. Don't want to get into that. No expert, but that's kind of the synopsis on that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Next question. What is meant by brightened?
Oh, brightened. That's great. Maybe a live demonstration is the best for that. So what I can do is I can take Mia's voice is probably the best here for an example, because she has a very bright voice. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take off the master chain. And I'm going to demonstrate kind of how you sound without what I call the brightening plugin. So I'm going to take off the EQ, which is adding more air or more high frequencies, more this OTT and this fresh air. And we'll compare between the two. So here we go. There's kind of a muffled texture to that, but when you bring in these plugins, there's more of a shininess to it, you can hear.
So it's like sounding clearer, more airy, more sharper, more shiny.
Clarity is probably the big word for brightness. I agree with that. Yeah.
And darker will just be like the opposite. Like the darker sound muffled. Will just be like something more bassy, more warmer sounding.
Yes. Warm. Yes. Okay. Oh, next one.
Next question. We're not gonna have like a list of the plugins, but you can check out Tomo's channel and his mixing streams where he will actually like bring the plugins.
Oh God! Wait, it's echoing. Hold on. Oh God! It's echoing.
Whoa.
I don't know why it's echoing. Okay, I just muted it. Anyways.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, and also, next one's really simple. The DAW that he is using is called Reaper, R-E-A-P-E-R. It is free. Go check it out. It's very cool.
Pog.
Mm-hmm. And next one, they asked, what if our listening sense isn't good at all and we don't know what sounds good enough to properly adjust?
I would like
to answer another question that asked the difference between different headphones and IEMs for mix and sound quality. First of all, upgrade your audio gear. If you're mixing on really bad headphones, then nothing is going to help because 100%. Everything is going to sound off. So first of all, upgrade your headphones or your IEMs or your earbuds. And then both of us, me and Tomo, took years of practice to like get where we are. So it's just a lot of practice getting used to different sounds.
Mm-hmm.
So it is just a lot of practice.
Mm-hmm. The best thing you can really do is start for yourself and then ask people. There's a lot of, I think mentorship is probably the biggest thing that helps people with learning mixing. And so just ask people, try and get involved in mixing something, offer to mix for someone if they're okay with it not sounding great. Or just ask, for example, like a lot of people will distribute their raw lines. You can give that a go as well and try mixing it yourself. But I'd say probably the best way to develop your ear is to mix things yourself. Watch other streams, copy what other people do, and tweak it to your own devices. Honestly, that's my best advice. Time will train your ears. I definitely didn't know what sounded good years ago, and it took lots and lots of practice. So I'm glad I can be where I am now, but it wouldn't have been there without a lot of the people helping me along the way, saying, you know, this sounds bad, or like, this sounds good. Right. Try this. Can I do this? And at a certain point, you'll notice people have different opinions, and that's okay. But take as much knowledge as you can, learn from it, and try to streamline your learning, I guess. So yeah, it takes time. You will not be as technical as me when you first start. You can just start with, say, you can take out a lot of what I do. You can just do EQ, compression, reverb, limiting, and you have a mix there. It's fine. It's not going to be the same level necessarily, but it's a start. It'll sound good for a majority of things. Like, it will sound better than, say, like 75% of unmixed stuff out there, or 75% of unmixed stuff. So a lot of stuff that's on the internet isn't mixed because they're home videos and new stuff. So it's just a practice time. It's a practice game and working it over time. So you will get there.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So sorry. There's a few more.
Yes.
So
go. Sorry, long answer.
How do you limit yourself from over-editing? When do you know when to stop? When you start feeling that the original starts sounding better than the edited. If it starts sounding robotic, stop. If it starts sounding like you don't sound like yourself anymore, stop. That's my basis.
Yeah. Definitely.
Oh, this next one, you could probably show an example. Could you give an example of thick versus thin? And I would just like to say that thick is just going to be a lot of bass and thin is just going to be like almost no bass.
Do you want
to like show it with an EQ?
I can also do compression and no compression. So I'll do no compression versus compression real quick. And then I'll do... I'll do an EQ slider. So let me just turn off all the compression on the mains right here and solo them so we can kind of get an idea here. So this is thin in the volume sense. Bring the effects back on. And then we'll put the volume back on. This is thick in a volume sense. Just a lot more compressed. Now, probably what Mio is asking for on the EQ side is thickness versus thinness. So I'm just going to take this low frequency here and I'm just going to boost the heck out of it.
I guess it's like sounding fuller and sounding more tinny.
Yes.
Yeah.
Versus I take out the thickness. Very thin. It's just from a vocal editing perspective. You can't see the graph. I'm so stupid. Okay, let me bring back the graph. Here we are.
Apparently the speakers aren't too great, so it's kind of hard to tell.
Oh,
hopefully
okay.
You
Sorry.
Can hear it
very,
in the playback
very thin.
Later afterwards.
Okay, here we go. So thin. Thick. Thin. Thin. Thick. Big thickest. Anyways, that's that.
Okay.
Next question?
Next question. Do you apply the same effect presets for each mix? If not, are there any that you apply and don't change?
Good one.
I think for the same vocalist, you tend to use the same preset and it will save a lot of time. However, if the genre becomes totally different, or if the, you know, obviously if you change your microphone, then things will change a little bit. But for the most part, things will kind of stay the same.
I have a different answer for that, but yeah.
Oh, okay. I guess like if it's your own voice that you mix all the time, then there's not much change, but that could just be me.
Oh, no, that's fine. Yeah, that's a valid approach. And my approach also is I kind of actually start most every mix from scratch, but the only things I'll copy a lot of similar plugins. So for example, my R compressor, which is like, let me pull it up again. One of my other compressors in chain. This one, most of my compression is almost always on the same settings. So like this Pro QC, Pro CQ, whatever. Pro C. This R comp is usually on the same settings. Fresh Air is usually around the same settings. Pro MB is usually around the same settings. But for thing, Spiff is usually on the same settings. Doubler is always on the same settings. But things like imaging, saturation, EQ, I will change every single vocalist, every single mix basically. So Pro Q, OTT, these two are kind of different components that I use to tweak the sound of each individual vocalist. And this is across, I just don't copy and paste between the mixes. I create every mix from scratch and just use the same settings mostly for me. Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Next question. Do you use stereo monitor headphones or have, before that. If the timing is too off, would you need to re-record? If there anything you'd recommend to improve timing in the recording process? Honestly, you just have to practice to the singing like along to the song and like just getting it as close as possible. You don't have to be too close because at some point we can just edit it all. Mm-hmm. But if it's too off, then even if we do fix it, it will sound robotic.
Yeah, definitely. I'd say when you're in the ballpark, it's pretty okay. You just kind of got to get within the ballpark.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We'll just do the ones that are here right now and then we'll be done.
Yes.
Do you use stereo monitor headphones or have a stereo monitor setup, Tomo?
Oh, I use both. I have three sets of headphones that I use and then four if you include AirPods and then one set of studio monitors all to give me a different picture. What about you, Mio?
I just mix on IEMs. I use a Sennheiser HD1. How long can you typically go or mix before your ears become fatigued?
Ooh, good question. Ooh. Used to be a lot shorter when I was like just starting out because I like didn't know what I was doing and I do a lot of things to damage my, or not damage my ears, but you know, fatigue them. Now I can go for like 5-6 hours just fine. It's really only until I hit like the 12-hour mark that I'm like, I'm just tired of mixing. I don't think it's so much fatigue.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. What about you?
I think for me it's like editing, I can go as long as I want. I think mixing, you definitely need some time to like refresh and then come back to it and you can do a lot more things.
Yeah.
Just because your ears get accustomed to it so much.
Right. The mental pause is really important. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next one. What headphones do you recommend? I like, this is like very subjective, but I like the Sennheisers because the Sennheisers have a very clear high end and I like having a like really clear high frequencies. So I like to use my Sennheisers. Tomo mixes on stereo, so I guess that's a little different.
Yeah, I don't really have a favorite because I just have a lot of different things that give me different pictures. So I can't really recommend a best one, honestly. But right now, the ones I enjoy using, honestly, okay, gonna hate me, but I really like AirPods just for that sound because it tells you kind of how everyone else will hear the mix, right?
Right.
So I like that neutral, semi-neutral perspective, and that's probably my best tool for checking a mix to see if it's in line with other things. But yeah. Otherwise, the headphones I use right now are the Sennheiser X Mass Drop HD 6XX. I use Genelec 800S something or other studio monitors, and my old headphones with the Sennheiser HD 280 Pros, and they're not that great, but I still like them. And I have a Sony set too, but I don't know what they're called. But they're green.
Okay. And our last question, do you mix backing vocals harmonies differently than main vocals? And if so, what do you do specifically? And do you double track your vocals? I'll just answer the second one first, because double tracking really just depends on the song. If you're recording for like K-pop, then yes, you want to record lots of layers. If you're recording for like a ballad, then you just need like one take.
Mm-hmm.
You can answer the harmony
mixing. Yes. So for harmony mixing, I actually have a few other things here. I didn't really do much on this mix specifically that I can show actually, but what I usually do is I just compress them a little bit more, put a de-esser on them so they sit back in the mix a little bit, and I'll just spread them, depending on the song, I'll spread them a little wider. I always double track my harmonies so I can pan one left and one right, as you can see here, left, right, but not everyone does that. That's just personal preference. So up to you. I just think it has a warmer sound, or a fuller sound, but not everyone does that. It's just my style.
Okay, and I think that's it. Thank you so much for coming to our panel today. Thank you so very much for listening to us, showing you a little bit on what we do. And I do hope that you go check out the actual upload for our Daddy Daddy Do TV Size cover that we prepared for today's panel. I hope you enjoy the rest of your day at Offkai and go check out everyone else's panels and meet and greets and fun events as well. Thank you so much for attending.
Yes,
lovely
thank
beings.
You so much. And oh, see whoa, you whoa. Again. What?
Why do I hear echo? Oh wait, is this from Parsec?
Oh no.
Okay.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for coming, guys. We're gonna roll the ending screen here. For those of you who do not come to my streams, you will be in for a surprise. All right. Thank you so much for coming, and we'll see you all next time. All right.
Thank you. Go check out our channels.
Yeah.
Go support
VTubers. Go enjoy your rest of your COD. Have fun.
Oh my god, you guys are waving. That's so cute. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right. Banger outro.
What is up, guys? Thank you so much for watching. Before you go, be sure to leave a like, comment, and subscribe. We're almost to 100,000 subscribers, so if you could hit the bell and share, I'd really appreciate it. I post every Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, so I'll be sure to make it worth your time. Alright, that's all, my dudes. Remember, as always, love, peace, and weed.